Our next topic in our chapter on heat energy deals with enthalpy. Enthalpy of a system is denoted with a capital H. I often think of H as being the heat of a reaction. Enthalpy of a system is the sum of the internal energy of the system and the product of the pressure and the volume. In other words, when chemistry actually is happening, not just heat flow from a hot object to a cold object, but when we actually have bonds breaking and new bonds forming, when the system is the actual chemical change we are studying, the correct term for that type of energy is called enthalpy, and it gets denoted as an H, a capital H for the term enthalpy. We can see that endo and exothermic reactions denote with a negative sign for exothermic when the change in enthalpy, heat being released by the system, will be termed exothermic and gets a sign showing negative. Heat is being lost by the system to the surroundings. Reactions where delta H is positive shows an endothermic reaction. The system is gaining heat energy from the surroundings. And this is simply showing a chemical heat pack and a chemical cold pack. A cold pack representing an endothermic process where ammonium nitrate dissolves in water. Endothermic process, your hands would actually get cold holding on to this chemical change. If heat is being released to the surroundings from the system, we called that an exothermic, and your hand would actually get warm to the touch. Endo is heat absorbing from the surroundings. Exo is heat releasing to the surroundings. Endo is a positive sign. Exo is a negative sign. Taking a closer look at a molecular view of exothermic reactions. For exothermic, the surrounding temperature rises due to the release of thermal energy by the reaction. This extra thermal energy comes from the conversion of some of the chemical potential energy in the reactants into kinetic energy in the form of heat. So during the course of our reaction, old bonds are broken and new bonds are made. If the products of the reaction have less chemical potential energy than the reactants, that difference of energy is then released as heat. Again, as reactants turn to products, if heat is released, the energy of the products was at a lower state. The enthalpy of reaction is a chemical reaction is an extensive property. In other words, the more reactants you use, the larger the enthalpy change. So by convention, we calculate the enthalpy change for the number of moles of reactants in a reaction. And let's just take a look at what this could be interpreted as with this example. C3H8 is a molecule known as propane. We often use propane in our gas grills at home, or some people actually heat their homes with propane. When it combusts, it reacts with oxygen from the air, forming carbon dioxide gas and water vapor. When propane combusts with oxygen, it releases carbon dioxide and water. The delta H, the enthalpy of reaction, is negative 2044 kilojoules of energy. The negative sign shows exothermic. We just said we use propane as a fuel to either cook our food or heat our homes. We can see that there's energy being released that we trap as thermal energy. To read this, see the coefficient in front of the propane molecule as a 1. For every 1 propane molecule that combusts, 2,044 kilojoules of heat is released. Or, for every 5 moles of oxygen that combust, 2,044 kilojoules of heat is released. What we're reminding ourselves is that delta H is just like any other part of the balanced equation and can be placed into any stoichiometric ratio with want over given, grabbing kilojoules per mole. And let's model what one of those would look like. In example 6.7, how much heat is evolved in the complete combustion of propane? And the mass that they're giving us is 13.2 kilograms. 13.2 kilograms of propane. Well, just as a side note, this kilogram should be placed into a gram unit as entering into our stoichiometry roadmap. I remember that 1,000 grams is equivalent to 1 kilogram, that prefix kilo stands for 1,000. So if we simply multiply 13.2 by 1,000, we'll just slide the decimal place. I can show that, but you can probably do that as mental math. Sliding the decimal to get rid of the kilo gives us 13,200 grams. And that's where we'll begin this journey. 13,200 grams of propane, C3H8. This is what we call our given, and we want to know, kilojoules, kJs of heat. We know that coefficients stand for mole numbers, not mass values, so we need to do a little mole map work. We need to look up a molar mass of our molecule propane and use that to convert into the mole. Carbon with a weight of 12, and I see 3 of them in the formula, so 12 times 3, plus hydrogen, who has a weight of 1, but there's 8 of them all together in our formula. The molar mass of propane molecule is 44. That tells us that every 1 mole of our propane, C3H8, would weigh 44 grams. The gram units cancel and it brings us into the mole. We're now ready to do the heart of our problem, the stoichiometric ratio of want over given. We want to know kilojoules of heat energy. There's 2,044 kJs of heat released for every 1 mole of propane that combusts. A want over given ratio of 2044 set over 1. We've canceled the grams, we've canceled the mole unit, and we're left with our target, the kilojoules of heat. And let's hit that together and see if we get a common answer. Starting with 13,200 grams, divide by 44 and multiply by negative 2044, and we find a value 613,200. And the negative sign lets you know we know it's exothermic. So 613,200 kilojoules. Again, we used a mole conversion and then a stoichiometric ratio, want over given, where we targeted kilojoules from the mole of reactant propane. Our next practice, very similar. How much heat is evolved when 0.438 grams of diamond is burned? Well, diamond is pure carbon, and carbon, written as a solid, combusts with oxygen. That's the pattern of chemical change. Burning is a combustion pattern, and the process would simply form carbon dioxide. Carbon dioxide is our product. To turn this equation into a thermochemical equation, it tells us the heat of combustion is negative 395.4 kilojoules for every mole of carbon. And that's exactly what our equation is showing us. Every 1 mole of carbon is going to release 395.4 kilojoules of energy for every 1 mole of carbon that combusts. So suppose instead of 1 mole, we started with 0.483 grams of diamond. Diamond is written as C for carbon. How much heat energy would be evolving then? We need to do a little mole map work to convert our gram unit into a mole unit. So we look up the atomic weight of carbon. Its molar mass is 12. If we had 1 mole of carbon, it would weigh 12 grams. The stoichiometric ratio says negative 395.4 kilojoules of heat are released for every 1 mole of carbon. Our want over given ratio. We'll simply calculate to solve for kilojoules. 0.483 divided by 12 converts us into a mole, and multiply by negative 395.4 kilojoules. And the heat of combustion is negative 15.91 kilojoules of heat. Negative shows we know heat is being released, which is another word for evolved. Evolution of heat is an exothermic process. The process we used often to measure the change in enthalpy, delta H, is calorimetry, and we have used a foam cup calorimeter before together. Calorimetry is simply using an insulated cup to create a nestled system, preventing heat flow to the outside surroundings. As you've been reviewing, we see that the Q for reaction is negative Q for the solution. In other words, the water absorbs heat as the equation releases heat. We understand that Q is heat energy, mc delta T, where a solution is a water-based aqueous solution, so we tend to use 4.18 joules per gram Celsius. The heat of the reaction is Q of the reaction. We're measuring it with a coffee cup calorimeter. So to get delta H for the reaction per mole, we've got to divide by the number of moles of our reactant. And let's just take a modeled example. We're on slide 29. That reads, what is the delta H of a reaction in moles of magnesium? If magnesium solid is placed into aqueous hydrochloric acid, producing magnesium chloride aqueous and hydrogen gas. Our given is 0.158 grams of magnesium. We place that into 100 milliliters of solution, and the temperature changes from 25.6 to 32.8. Let's first solve for the heat being absorbed by the water, the solution chemistry. So Q is mc delta T, solving for the water first. The water is absorbing the heat energy as this reaction proceeds. So the mass of the water given to us is 100 milliliters, but keep in mind the density of water is 1, so instead of 100 mils, we'll simply convert that to a gram unit. The density of water is 1 gram per mil, so those are indeed allowed to be changed. That's not true for any substance, but it is for water. Specific heat constant for water we have memorized is 4.18 joules per gram degree Celsius. And the temperature difference, well, let's just hit that. We can see we would have 32.8 minus 25.6, so the temperature changed by 7.2 degrees. Solving for joules of energy that was absorbed by the water. 100 times 4.18 times 7.2. 3009.6 joules of energy absorbed for the water. Now think about what that represents. That's the heat change when 0.158 grams of magnesium reacted. We're being asked to report this value in moles of magnesium. So let's just do a little mole work. If 0.158 grams of magnesium reacted, let's simply convert that into the mole unit by using its molar mass. We know that 1 mole of magnesium, looking on our periodic table, we can find its atomic weight, and it's 24.3 grams. 1 mole of magnesium would weigh 24.3. So let's take our mass, 0.158. We'll divide that by 24.3, and that simply converts the gram unit into the mole unit, 0.0065 moles of magnesium. Now friends, look what we have. We have joules of heat, and we have moles of magnesium. We're being asked to solve for the heat of the reaction, which is joules per mole. The delta H for the reaction per mole of magnesium is simply found by taking 3009.6 joules, dividing it by our mole number solved above, and just getting to the desired units of joules per mole. 3009.6 divided by that previous answer, the moles of magnesium, and we get a large number, 462.868, and I'll round 0.9 joules of energy. And that's reporting that in terms of per mole of magnesium. What might be a little easier for us to read instead of this large number is converting joules into kilojoules, which often delta H's are reported as. So 462, and I'll just round a little bit, kilojoules per mole would be a more common way to express that value. This number for joules was rather large. I slid the decimal 3 spots to the left to simply change the joule unit into the kilojoule. So when 0.158 grams of magnesium was placed into acid, it released heat. The heat that was released was absorbed by the water. Heat released by the reaction was absorbed by the water. The water absorbed, that's a positive sign, it absorbed 3009.6 joules. Therefore, the heat was being released by the reaction. I better show that I know that reaction to be exothermic and place a negative sign at the end. Heat absorbed by the water must have been released by the chemical change. Negative 462.9 kilojoules per mole. Let's try another. Perhaps you'd like to pause and try this one and then turn the video back on and follow. It reads, what will be the final temperature of a solution in a coffee cup calorimeter when 50 mils of a sample of hydrochloric acid is added to 50 mils of a sample of base? The initial temperature is 19.5 degrees Celsius, and the heat of reaction is 57.2 kilojoules per mole of sodium hydroxide. Let's just pause and see what they're really saying. The reactants, those things that are actually doing chemical change, the first reactant is hydrochloric acid, HCl. I'm placing that into a second reactant. It's sodium hydroxide, NaOH. When an acid and a base react, they neutralize. The pattern of change we call a double replacement. H goes to OH. We commonly write that as water, HOH. I'll write that as water. And sodium then hooks to chloride. We get NaCl. Clean sheet of paper, and let's revisit our equation. And we need to get this right so that it makes sense. Get rid of this pen. HCl with NaOH, acid-base chemistry, will produce a water molecule and sodium chloride, NaCl. Important to note, the delta H for the reaction says when this occurs, negative 57.2 kilojoules of heat are released for every 1 mole of sodium hydroxide that reacts. That's what the sentence is saying. Here's what I also know. I have 50 milliliters of HCl. Its concentration is 0.250 molar. And we have 50 mils of sodium hydroxide whose concentration is 0.25 molar. Last chapter, we spent some time with a round little buddy for molarity. Moles per liter is big M molarity. Molarity times liter gets me the number of moles. That's what I need to find to convert this into moles of NaOH. I'm going to take 0.25 molar, and I'm going to multiply it by 0.5 liters of solution. 0.25 molar times 0.05 liters says this reaction is being carried out with 0.0125 moles of NaOH. And since it's the same values for acid, we were correct in assuming there's no limiting and no excess reagent, But let's use the volume times molarity to actually put it into moles of reactant and moles of base. Then I can revisit this value here, the delta H for reaction. Negative 57.2 kilojoules would have been released if we used a whole mole of NaOH, but we did not deliver a mole. We only delivered 0.0125 moles. How many kilojoules of heat were released for the small amount of base and acid we added? 57.2 times 0.0125 tells us 0.715 kilojoules of heat were released for this particular equation. And again, release, so I'll show it's negative. Now I can go back to the MC delta T problem and work it with the correct joules of energy. I'm going to multiply this by 1,000. Maybe you just want to slide that over in your head. 7150, again, if that's something you'd like to see hit out, 715 joules of energy. So that allowed me to get rid of the decimal, put it into joules. 715 joules of heat is equal to the combined mass of the solution, 100 grams. Water is our solvent, so 4.18 joules per gram Celsius. And now let's solve for a delta T that's going to make sense. Again, the conversion using molarity times liter helped me convert the kilojoule into an appropriate number for the small amount of reactants we added. We did not use entire mole values. So a little algebra. Let's hit 715 divided by 100 divided by 4.18. This number makes so much more sense. The delta T, the change in temperature, 1.71 degrees. If the water started at 19.5 degrees, our problem read for us, and again, that's being pulled from up here, 19.5. The final temperature comes out to be 21.21 degrees Celsius. That makes so much more sense because water should warm up a little. It has such a high heat capacity. When I saw in my last practice where I had water ending up at 150 degrees, I knew I took a wrong turn. That number just did not make sense. So back to the drawing board we went, and we corrected the problem using molarity times liter to find the correct number of moles. We adjusted the kilojoules for the amount of reactant we used. That kilojoule was changed to a joule, and again, 0.715 kJs, change into 715 joules. That becomes the heat energy. We set the MC delta T. How much heat did the water absorb? That was 715 joules. Divided by the mass of the combined solution, divide again by the heat capacity of water. The water changed a little by 1.71 degrees. This number makes so much more sense. 21.21 degrees Celsius, the final temperature reading on that water.
Let's just take a look at this picture. In this beaker, this would represent our foam cup calorimeter. We're going to place cold water into this foam cup. Now, in this particular example, we're placing 255 grams. So I'm just kind of tabulating a little bit about the information. The mass of the cold water that we're placing in this example is 225 grams. Now in our lab, we are using 100 grams measured by the volume by the graduated cylinder measuring out 100 mils. But in this made-up example, we'll start with 225 grams of cold water. We have an initial temperature of this cold water, and it says that it's starting at 21 degrees Celsius. We know its mass, we know its initial temperature, and we also know one other piece of information, and that's the specific heat of our particular water. By its very definition, we know it to be 4.184 joules per gram degrees Celsius. Just as we had mentioned, the very definition when we talked about calories or joules of energy, The heat content of water is the standard in which we measure everything else as a comparison. 4.184 joules per gram degree Celsius is the specific heat for liquid water, and it is a constant. You can count on that each and every time you work these problems for water. So we know the specific heat, we know the initial temperature, and we know the mass of the water. There's some other information that we know in this example, and that's for the iron that's starting quite hot. Now in our lab, I know it will be copper, but here the example is talking about iron. This picture here is showing a glowing red hot chunk of iron metal. Its initial temperature is at 99.8 degrees Celsius. It's also telling us its mass is 55 grams. So from this part of the picture, we can see the initial temperature and how much that hot iron weighs. Now remember, in our lab, we're getting the copper metal hot by using a saucepan, right? And so we start with a very, very hot piece of metal and some very cold water. We put the system together, and that's what this is showing us. When I take the metal and drop it carefully into the cold water, we start to see heat flow. Heat is a type of energy that flows from a hot object to a cold object. You can see here the temperature has finalized at 23.1 degrees Celsius. The cold water warmed up and the hot metal cooled down. And what we now find is that the final temperature is going to be the same number for both systems. It's 23.1 Celsius degree. The final temperature is 23.1 Celsius degree. So that's in common. So what we understand is heat flows from the hot object to the cold object. Heat flows from the hot metal to the cold water. And the first law of thermodynamics is very clear that says heat lost must be equal to heat gained. Q equals Q. Heat lost is equal to heat gained. So heat, we know, is Q. We've learned that in our lessons from our chapter. Heat is a, I'm going to say lost, just so we see what L and Q means, and this is gained. Heat loss is equal to heat gained. And we also understand that heat can be measured by knowing its mass times specific heat times the change in temperature. If we know for the cold water the mass, the specific heat, and its change in temperature, our first task is to measure how much heat was gained by the cold water, because it would be exactly equal to the MC delta T for the iron, or the copper, the iron in this problem, in terms of how much heat was lost by the hot metal. I'll call it metal from now on because this picture was actually showing us iron, but I know our lab is going to use copper pennies. Alrighty. So here's what we know. We're going to say step one, let's solve for the heat gained by the water, heat gained by cold water. And you'll do this for all three trials, but I'll do it just with this one example. So the heat gained by the water is going to be equal to the mass of the cold water. Now remember, I put in this made-up example, 225 grams of water was sitting in this beaker. You will be using 100 measured by your graduated cylinder, but I'm going to follow this story problem. 225, you're going to model yours after this example. We all have the same specific heat constant, joules per gram degree Celsius, always the value for water. It is a physical property that's unique to water. Just like water, it boils at 100 Celsius, freezes at 0 Celsius. Its specific heat content is 4.184. Now, the change in temperature for the cold water It started at 23.1 degrees. No, it started at 21 and warmed up to 23.1. See the difference there? TF minus TI, 23.1 minus 21, it changed by 2.1 degrees. I have the mass of the cold water sitting in your foam cup. This is the specific heat constant we use for water, 4.184. This is the change in temperature, from where it started to where it landed, and in this example we said it warmed up by 2.1 Celsius degree. I'm going to hit 225 times 4.184 times 2.1, and I'm going to find joules of energy by doing so. When I hit 225 times specific heat of 4.184 times my delta T of 2.1, I find a value of 1976.94, and that unit would be joules of energy. Remember what this represents. This is the heat absorbed by the cold water. We know now that that same quantity of heat absorbed is equal to the heat lost by the metal, by the hot metal. We use that Q, the heat that we just calculated, to solve for the specific heat of the metal. Alrighty. So again, it's Q is equal to MC delta T. The Q we just solved for up above. The M is the mass of my metal. The change in temperature is subtracting TF minus TI. And this is our target variable now. The target is the specific heat. So I'm pulling out from here the answer to the heat gained by water, 1976.94 joules. Heat gained is equal to heat loss. So once we calculated the heat gained by water, it now becomes the Q for the next set of problems. How much did our hot metal weigh? In this example, it was 55 grams. You will be using the mass of your copper penny for this step, but I'm going to model my problem here. 55 grams, the mass of this hot iron. The specific heat is my target variable. I have to keep scrolling to find these numbers. The temperature changed 99.8 and 23.1. So the difference between the TI and TF, 99.8, subtract out the final 23.1. I get 76.7 degrees Celsius. That's my temperature change. So notice a significant difference here. Water warmed a little, but the metal sure cooled down a lot, and that's very normal. You probably noticed the same thing in your experiment. Now let's rearrange this to solve for C, the specific heat. To isolate the variable C, we have to say 1976.94 joules divided by 55 times 76.7. You want to put that in a parenthesis to make sure you're taking the product of those two numbers. 1976.94 divided by parenthesis 55 times 76.7. And I get an answer that is 0.46, and I'll round a little bit, 9 joules per gram degree Celsius. Alrighty. This is the specific heat of our metal. Two steps we followed. Step one. In step one, we used all the information about the cold water and solved for Q, MC delta T for your cold water. Step two, we used that answer for the Q, the heat lost by the metal. We knew its mass, we knew its delta T, and we pulled out the specific heat of the metal. You're going to be asked to calculate your percent air, and I'll just remind you of that formula. The percent air says take your experimental value and subtract it from the theoretical value provided for you in your lab report. Take that difference and always make it positive. Remember, these lines here just simply represent absolute value, so that we always report error as a positive number. So we're just taking the difference between what we got in the lab. So this is your lab answer. This is the published correct answer. What do we accept to be true? The difference between your answer and the correct answer divided by the correct answer expressed as a percent will show how you got your error. This is what we would refer to as our experimental value, what we ended up calculating based on lab results. It is the ice cube question. So here we're given two 20-gram ice cubes at negative 16 degrees Celsius, and they're placed into 275 grams of water at 25 degrees Celsius. Assuming there's no energy transferred in or from around the surroundings, calculate the final temperature of the water after all the ice melts. So we actually have three processes here to consider. One, we know that the ice will melt. That's exactly why we put ice cubes into a warm water or beverage, because we want that liquid to cool down and be more tasty. So we have to melt the ice. And to melt ice, that's going to require energy. The energy that it will absorb to melt comes from the warmer water. So just to kind of consider where we're at on a line segment graph, we're starting at negative 16 degrees Celsius. And we know that that ice will warm up from negative 16 to zero, and then at which it will undergo a phase change in which it will go from solid to liquid. So in other words, we have two line segments to solve for. Line segment AB will be an MC delta T problem, where we're solving for the amount of energy needed to warm up an ice cube from negative 16 to zero. And then line segment BC will be a phase change. We call that delta H of fusion, the enthalpy of fusion here, in which it will melt. So here we're just going to use our delta H of fusion and melt the ice. So two different line segments, and I'll show my work over here. For the first line segment, we had two 20 grams of ice. So really, the net weight there is 40 grams of ice. The specific heat for solid water given right here, notice is in a joule per mole Kelvin. So if we have 40 grams, we have to do a little mole map work to make sure that we are agreeing in the unit. So 40 grams of ice, which is solid water, multiplied by a little mole map conversion using the molar mass of H2O as 18. That's just simply summing two H's and an O. We're just doing a simple mole map conversion of turning grams into moles. And let me hit that. Hit it with me, because I'm known to make calculator mistakes once in a while, as we all do. 40 divided by 18 gives us 2.22 moles repeating. And I'll just remind us that every time I'm writing water, it's in the solid phase, but that's not changing the molar mass at all. So we're really given 2.22 moles of ice. And that's just that conversion there. 220 gram ice cubes is the same as saying 2.22 moles of solid water. So then we're ready to kind of plug in the equation. We have 2.22 moles of solid water. I can multiply that by the provided number here, that it takes 37.7 joules per mole Kelvin. And we have to then multiply that by the delta T, the change in temperature. And if we're starting at negative 16 and rising to zero, it is changing by 16 units, 16 Kelvin units, which are equivalent to Celsius units. So notice what we've done. First line segment, we got moles to cancel. We got Kelvin units to cancel by our delta T value, and we'll end with joules of energy. Let me hit that with you. 2.22 moles times 37.7 joules per mole Kelvin, there's Daisy, times 16, our delta T. And I found 1339.104, way too many sig figs, but I'm going to leave them for now and just kind of round at the end. So our first line segment AB for the first part of melting the ice. Let's continue thinking about this phase change from line segment B to C. We've got ice now at 0 degrees and it needs to melt. So we're going to call that line segment BC. When I set up this math, notice that the heat of fusion here is provided in a kJ per mole. So I'm going to start with this mole unit again, just to make sure that I have an agreeable unit. 2.22 moles of solid water is going to melt, and when it does so, it uses 6.01 kilojoule for every 1 mole. That's a kJ per mole. Notice this unit above is in a joule. This unit right here will end in a kilojoule, so I'm just going to multiply that out and make sure that I end with like units. I know that a kilo is 1,000. So I'll hit that with us. 2.22 times 6.01 times 1,000. And here I'm finding a value, 13342.2 joules. Let's sum the two. We have 1339.104 from our first line segment added to 13342.2 from our second line segment. What is the sum for the total amount of energy? And I'm finding that to be 14681.304 joules of energy. This is the required energy to melt the ice. Well, where does that energy come from? We mentioned in the beginning the energy had to be provided from cooling the liquid water. So let's do this next. Cooling the liquid water is going to change its temperature. So we need to solve for how much that temperature changed for. Our new target now is delta T. So let's kind of get our bearings. A second system is going on. We have water starting at 25 degrees. And that water, for my example, was 275 grams. Now, that's the number that may change from person to person as sampling generates different values. So you just want to be sure you're checking your numbers. Our process is going to be identical, but just make sure you're noticing where I'm pulling these numbers from as I solve my problem. Yours may match or they may be different. Just be careful about that. But I had 275 grams of liquid water. And I want to know, where does it end up cooling? Right. So it's going to be an MC delta T problem. I know the mass. I know the specific heat. What I want to know is the delta T when I pull out this much energy from its system. So my Q equal MC delta T utilizes the previous answer, the amount of energy needed to melt the ice is being pulled out of the system from the water that was at 25 degrees. What I also notice is that the specific heat for water in a liquid is also given on a mole per Kelvin, joule per mole Kelvin unit. So this 275 grams of water, I just want to check, 275 grams of water also needs to be converted into a mole. And again, even though it's in the liquid phase, the molar mass of water is still 18. So I'm just going to hit that for us so we have that handy. 275 divided by 18 is the same as saying 15.278, we'll say, 278 moles of water. So this value now, 14,681.3 joules of energy, plunking in my mole value, then I can use my specific heat here, heat capacity 75.3 provided in the data table. And notice that's a joule per mole Kelvin. And what we don't know is the delta T. So how much it changed by. Now, a couple of interesting things. We can just put delta T here and solve for that variable and then go back to the original temperature of 25 and subtract delta T to find TF. I mean, I know that that temperature is going to cool to some point. By solving for delta T, I can take 25 minus that answer and find where it lands. So our delta T calculation will involve this following algebra, 14,681.3 divided by the product of 15.278 times 75.3. So just rearranging that to solve for delta T. And let's hit that together, be sure we're getting the same answer. So 14,681.3 divided by parenthesis 15.278 times 75.3, close parenthesis. We want to make sure we're taking the product on the bottom. Don't make a calculator error and forget those parentheses. And I hit that wrong. I'm going to hit it again. 14,681.3 divided by parentheses 15.278 times 75.3. That looks much better. Took me two tries. 12.76 is our change in temperature. It's not our answer. It's how much it changed by. So remember where we started. It started at 25 degrees Celsius. And if it cooled by 12.76 degrees, I'm going to say 25 minus that answer, and the final temperature of that system is 12.24 degrees Celsius. So it started at 25, and it's going to land at 12.24. That energy was used to melt the ice cubes. We're not quite done, however, because remember, we have the original ice is still at 0 degrees. It's liquid now, but it was once ice. It's at zero. And now we have, we had 40 grams of ice originally. Now at 0 degrees as a liquid. And we have over here a system that's 275 grams of water at 12.24 degrees. I understand that they're not going to just stay separate. They're going to blend together, 0 degree water and 12 degree water. They're going to mix together. And what is ultimately their final temperature? So again, if temperature is changing, we know we have an MC delta T problem for what was originally the ice set equal to what was originally the liquid water. And I'm going to use those mole values again because the specific heats were given in moles. So I'm going to go back up and grab some numbers. Remember the ice scenario. We had 2.22 moles of the original ice. And here on the opposite side, we had 15.278 moles of water. So we had more there, 15.278. Both of them are in the same phase. They're both liquid right now. So the 75.3 joule per mole Kelvin is going to be identical on both sides. There's no ice left. It's all liquid water. So that number will eventually just drop out. Now here's the scenario, this delta T part. I have the ice that's now at zero, and I know eventually it's going to warm up as it blends with a 12 degree system. So I know that the final temperature will be larger or a higher number than zero. So my variable here is TF minus zero. Over here, I know that the 12.24 is going to cool down, and so I'm going to represent the delta T there as saying 12.24 minus TF, where TF is representing the final temperature of both systems. Right off the bat, these two guys just eliminate out of the equation, don't they? So that's just simplified. We have a mole of liquid water, 2.22, times TF minus zero. Notice that when I distribute 2.22 times TF, I'm letting that be represented here. 2.22 times zero just simply drops out. So the whole left side now has just been simplified as 2.22 TF. Here we do have to distribute, so I'm going to multiply 15.278 times 12.24. 15.278 times 12.24, and I'm getting 187.00274 minus, and then distribute here, you're going to get 15.278 TF. Let's get the variables together. So I'm going to add 15.278 to both sides, 2.22 plus 15.278 is 17.498 TF, and that is equal to 187. Divide both sides to isolate your variable. $187 divided by that previous answer, and I'm finding a value of 69 degrees Celsius. Taking ice cubes and placing it into water and allowing them to mix, we had three different systems as we debrief what we've learned. Step one, the process of melting the ice, generated the amount of energy that we then carried forward into the second system to cool the liquid water. The third part was allowing the ice that is now at 0 degrees as a liquid and the water that was chilled down to 12 degrees to actually blend together. And finally, when I go to take a sip of this beverage, if all the ice is indeed melted, the resulting beverage is now landing at about 10.7 Celsius degrees.